9,000 more infants will be born with HIV because of reduced funding to the prevention of mother-to-child transmission programs. Food, education, and livelihood assistance will not be available to 419,000 children through the Presidential Fund to Prevent AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria. Funding to treat 403,000 people for HIV/AIDS will not be available. 1.9 million fewer insecticide-treated bed nets to prevent malaria will not be delivered. 44,000 fewer people will be treated for tuberculosis. And through multilateral programming, 1.1 million fewer combination vaccines will be made available. Now just think about it for a moment. You want a war in Afghanistan? The money is always available. You want a war in Iraq? The money flows like a river. You want a war in Libya? The money is instantaneously available. You want to give particular support to bail out the banks? The money is always available. You want to make certain that corporate bonuses remain in place? The money is always available. Why is it that the money is available for war and for the multinational excrescences of capitalism, but a tiny fraction of that money is never available for global public health? You want a social justice cause? So for those who are passionate social justice aficionados, these are issues, all of them, that speak to poverty, the elimination of poverty, and the building of a more decent international community. In Canada, the same struggle for social justice is reflected in the erosion of equality and the growing numbers who are impoverished. Do you remember when Ed Trott went in 1989, I was sitting beside Walter and I was thinking about it just before we started. In 1989, Ed Broadbent introduced a resolution into the House of Commons, supported by every single member in the House, regardless of party, to eliminate child poverty by the year 2000. Comes the year 2000, and the numbers, the absolute numbers of children in poverty have increased, and the percentage increased, the percentages have increased as well. The richest 1% in Canada, 246,000 Canadians with an average income of $405,000 a year took almost one-third of all the income growth between 1997 and 2007. 1% took almost one-third of all the growth in income. By the end of 2009, 3.8% of Canadians controlled $1.78 trillion of wealth in Canada, representing something like 67% of the wealth in the country. And the gap, according to outfits like the Conference Board, and for me, more legitimate outfits like the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives, the gap is forever widening. And naturally, therefore, we see the kinds of protests we are seeing. The inequality which is felt acutely by Aboriginal peoples, the inequality which always has an ethnic or racial dimension, the inequality which certainly has a gender dimension, whether one is speaking about jobs, poverty, daycare, housing, transit, disabilities, the nature of our First Nations, these are enormous struggles around the quest for equality. Enormous struggles against inequality, enormous struggles against poverty which compromise the lives people lead. We have dropped from 14th place to 22nd place in the list of OECD countries on the basis of our inequality index. In Canada, inequality between the rich and the poor relentlessly proceeds. So naturally, you get this magnificent group of protesters. who occupy Wall Street and occupy Bay Street. And I have to say that the rest of the world is looking on and thinking to itself, it's about time that that people responded as they should respond to the inequality, even in countries like the United States and Canada. And what's so interesting about it is that, of course, the protesters tend to be very young, and so many of them are new to the realm of social protest. Naomi Klein, a young woman for whom I have an unbounded respect and admiration, and that has nothing to do with any personal matters. Although my son is now at home and told me to say that. I can't get over the speech that Naomi made to the protesters on Wall Street. It was quite extraordinary. She made the point that in 1999, there was the major anti-globalization protest in Seattle. And she pointed out that while those protests were tremendously important, they were around a single event. They were around a G8 meeting, or an IMF meeting, or a World Bank meeting. They were always focused on a meeting, and they didn't have durability because when the meeting was over, the protest was over. But what's different about this is that it's not around an event, it's around a fixed target, and the dispute can go on for as long as you want it to go on. It will endure. You can put down roots in this protest. I love the fact that it's a non-violent protest, and people are so punctilious about making sure that it's respectful and dignified and non-violent. It can be energetic and ebullient, of course, but it is non-violent, and it stands for that whole realm of targets which deserve to be excoriated. And then Naomi points out, and I'll read directly, 10 years later, it seems as if there aren't any more rich countries, just a whole lot of rich people, people who got rich looting the public wealth and exhausting natural resources around the world. The point is, today everyone can see that the system is deeply unjust and careening out of control. Unfettered greed has trashed the global economy, and it's trashing the natural world as well. We're overfishing our oceans, polluting our water with fracking and deep water drilling, turning to the dirtiest forms of energy on the planet, like the Alberta tar sands, and the atmosphere cannot absorb the amount of carbon we're putting into it, creating dangerous warming. The new normal is serial disasters, economic and ecological. I was astounded by what's happening in Bangkok. A city of 9 million people has a flood from the surrounding rivers which endanger the entire population. The Americans are sending helicopters over to rescue people. These climatic convulsions, which Al Gore has now directly linked to global warming, are of course increasing both in frequency and in intensity. So Naomi goes on to say, what climate change means is that we have to do this on a deadline. This time our movement cannot get distracted, divided, burnt out, or swept away by events. This time we have to succeed. And I'm not talking about regulating the banks and increasing taxes on the rich, though that's important. I'm talking about changing the underlying values that govern our society. That's hard to fit into a single media-friendly demand. And it's also hard to figure out how to do it, but it's no less urgent for being difficult. And then she says, we've picked a fight with the most powerful economic and political forces on the planet. That's frightening. It's so interesting that at the World Economic Forum in Davos this year, they expressed concern, these multinational corporations who get together in this self-congratulatory charade every year. They pointed out that the most significant thing was inequality, and they better deal with inequality. That is to say, how do they take hold of an issue in order to pollute it for everyone else? And Naomi goes on to say, and as this movement grows from strength to strength, it will get more frightening. Always be aware that there will be a temptation to shift to smaller targets, like, say, the person sitting next to you at this meeting. After all, that's a battle that's easier to win. Don't give in to the temptation. I'm not saying don't call each other. But this time, let's treat each other as if we plan to work side by side and struggle for many, many years to come, because the task before will demand nothing less. Let's treat this beautiful movement as if it is the most important thing in the world, because it is, it really is. And I want to say to you that I'm not taken aback that there aren't finite demands, that it feels a little messy. That's the nature of the democratic process. As a matter of fact, the absence of specific demands gives the movement strength, because every time you make a demand, it can be dismissed by the establishment individually. And the fact that there are so many demands and we are inching our way to a rationale means that along the way there will be accommodations made and the movement will have some real successes. It is noteworthy that in honor of Martin Luther King just a couple of days ago, President Obama publicly acknowledged Occupy Wall Street and attempted gradually to incorporate them into his own dialectic. That's quite a bit of movement in 1 month for the President of the United States. So don't any of you ever feel anxious. The gains will be made, and the accommodations and concessions will be made. It's just a question of keeping at it. This is a university. I wanted to pretend to academic credentials, because I don't have any. They've allowed me to profess to profess, but I don't have credentials. But I did remember R.H. Tawney's wonderful book on equality, which I read when I was a kid. And I wanted just to read, even if it's a little arcane, and in the fairly overwrought prose of 1931, read as follows. Whatever conclusions may be drawn from the history of the last decade, for him that was the 1920s, one at least is indisputable. It is that democracy is unstable as a political system, as long as it remains a political system and nothing more. Instead of being as it should be, not only a form of government, but a type of society, and a manner of life which is in harmony with that type. To make it a type of society requires an advance along two lines. It involves, in the first place, the resolute elimination of all forms of special privilege which favor some groups and depress others, whether their source be differences of environment, of education, or of pecuniary income. It involves, in the second place, the conversion of economic power, not now often an irresponsible tyrant, into the servant of society, working within clearly defined limits and accountable for its actions to a public authority. Since to take these next steps is within our own power, we have less to fear from shocks from without than from nervousness within. If in this country democracy falls, it will fall not through any fortuitous combination of unfriendly circumstances, but from the insincerity of some of its professed defenders and the timidity of the remainder. It will fall because, when there was still time to make it unassailable, public spirit was too weak and class egotism too strong for the opportunity to be seized. If it stands, it will stand not because it has hitherto stood, but because ordinary men and women were determined that it should, and threw themselves with energy into broadening its foundations. To broaden democracy's foundations means, in the conditions of today, to destroy plutocracy and to set in its place an equalitarian society. You see, I could have been with you today. These intonations, currents, rivulets of social justice suffuse the human condition. And what is happening now with the protest movement is one of the most exhilarating phenomena of our times. The fact that it should coincide so exquisitely with Winnie Yang's Social Justice Week is not just fortuitous, it's divinely ordained. And I want to say to all of you that it would be really helpful and useful and appropriate to participate in the week fully. and to recognize that these struggles for social justice are global and local and never-ending. Thanks for having me.